Hi, thank you everyone for joining us. We'll just give it one more minute and then we'll begin. Okay, I think we can begin now. So greetings to everyone from World Resources Institute India, and thank you for joining us in today's webinar. My name is Shubhangi Gupta, and I'm a consultant in the climate program at WRI India. And today we're pleased to conduct the third session of our MSME training series on climate change on the theme Energy Efficiency, Approach, Opportunities, and Technology. This training series is being conducted in partnership with the Confederation of Indian Industry, who are a key player in the sector and work with MSMEs regularly. So some quick housekeeping rules before we begin. All attendees will remain in listen-only mode. Please use the chat box on the right to ask your questions and leave your comments. You can also type in questions for a specific speaker, and we shall redirect the message to them. In case of any trouble with the audio or video, please do message the organizers in the chat box. And finally, this webinar will be recorded and shared with all the registrants, along with this presentation slide deck and a summary document of all the questions asked during the session. So in case we weren't able to address your questions during the question and answer session due to the lack of time, don't worry, we'll definitely get back to you offline and also circulate it to everyone. So the COVID-19 pandemic has highlighted the highly inequitable nature of economic disasters, with MSMEs being the worst hit despite playing a critical role in the economy. Climate change poses a similar challenge with even more disastrous and inequitable impacts. The objective of this series is to build awareness amongst MSMEs on climate change and its impact on business, economy, and livelihoods. Provide them with a range of skill sets on how to address the challenges associated with climate action, such as finance and technology options, and thus build resilience to future economic impacts and preparedness towards future direct regulations on MSMEs regarding their emissions, energy efficiency, renewable energy, waste management, etc. It can also help MSMEs make the most of existing regulations, markets, and opportunities available globally and domestically, and help skilled practitioners champion sustainability and efficient operations within their organizations. By covering a variety of technical and non-technical topics taught by experts and practitioners from the field and industry, we hope that such a training series will help get the ball rolling towards a low carbon, profitable, and resilient MSME sector in India. The topics we plan to cover in this training series range from the fundamentals of climate change, and the first step of climate action, which is the accounting and reporting of greenhouse gas emissions, to three more technical topics on energy efficiency, renewable energy, and resource efficiency, to finally ending the series with possibly the most frequently cited challenge by MSMEs, which is finance and policies that can support the uptake of the various solutions discussed in the technical sessions. Thanks to the support of MacArthur Foundation, this training series is free and open for all. Every session is conducted online, and the recordings and session materials are uploaded on the WRI website. The links to the first two sessions conducted in September and November last year have been hyperlinked in the previous slide for your easy access. Finally, a certificate of participation is also awarded to every attendee, with an attendance of more than 70% of the total duration of the session. And in the case of a few technical sessions, an optional test is conducted on passing which the participant certificate is upgraded to a certificate of completion. With this overview of the training series, let's now begin with today's session. The third in the series on energy efficiency and the approach, opportunity, and technology options it holds for the MSME sector. Energy efficiency is a high-impact and cost-effective solution for reducing greenhouse gas emissions. As the MSME sector recovers from the effects of the COVID-19 pandemic, energy efficiency interventions don't just help reduce emissions, but also help reduce a business's expense towards energy consumption, with the monetary savings from this reduced energy consumption far outweighing the capital expenditure of investing in these energy efficient technologies. This will be showcased by our MSME speaker later on in the session. Energy efficiency has also been the primary focus of emission reduction by the government, leading to both a spectrum of financing schemes and opportunities that will be covered in the last session of the training series, but also an increased stringent regulatory landscape for different members of the Indian industry, including potential future regulations for energy efficiency on MSMEs. Such a shift towards more efficient operations can thus not only contribute to optimizing a company's balance sheet, but also prepare them for an enhanced future regulatory landscape, and also help enhance their competitiveness in the market by meeting the procurement requirements of corporate customers who are now increasingly looking at the environmental impacts of their operations, which you will also hear about from our speaker from a large corporate today. The session covers the basics of energy management, opportunities, and successful models of intervention and innovative technology solutions available to the MSME sector. We have with us a great lineup of speakers consisting of MSMEs, OEMs, experts, and technology suppliers. We'd now like to conduct a short poll, after which I'll take you through the agenda and then we can begin the session. Could I request Tejaswini to launch the poll, please? Thanks. So the question here is, according to you, the biggest challenge for implementing energy efficiency in MSMEs is the lack of what? Awareness, access to financing, policy incentives, or economies of scale? We'll give it about 10 or 20 more seconds. Okay. Could you show us the results? Great, thanks. So as you can see, I think we have the first two have got the highest votes, which is great because these are the two points we're going to be covering in today's session. Awareness and economies of scale, the last one are what we'll be covering today. And the second and third options are what we'll be covering in the last session of the series on finance and policies. So could I go back to the slide? Could you stop sharing this? Thanks. Great. So I'll quickly run you through the agenda for today. The awareness component from the poll is covered from various aspects today. We begin with Mr. Akshay Kaul from CII, who will take you through the approach to adopting energy efficiency interventions, including basics like how to identify the right energy efficiency option for your business. We then proceed to Mr. Amol Magdum from Godrej & Boyce, who will give a corporate's perspective and expectations with respect to energy efficiency in their supply chain and how they are facilitating such interventions. Then we have Mr. Suresh Manoharan from Best Color Solutions, which is an MSME that has adopted several energy efficiency options in their business. And Mr. Suresh will talk about how it has helped them optimize their costs and improve their performance. After that, we have Ms. Kajol from WRI India, who will address the issues of economies of scale, also from the poll, by introducing demand aggregation as a model to increase economic feasibility of these interventions in MSME clusters. In terms of scale, since many times due to their small size, interventions may not work out at the individual level. Finally, we have speakers from three companies who provide technology solutions for energy efficiency in different application areas for MSMEs. So without further ado, I would like to hand it over to Mr. Atik Sheikh from CII, who will be the moderator for today's session. Once again, I would like to thank you all for joining and hope you enjoy the session.
Thank you, Shivangi, for setting the context for the program. Now we will move on to the main agenda for our webinar, which is on the sharing of experience from the consultants, OEMs, the suppliers who have implemented many energy efficiency measures. So first presentation is from Akshay Kaul from CII GBC Green Business Center. So Akshay will be sharing his experience of working with various clusters in India like Tirupur, Ankleshwar, like what are the key approaches for implementing the energy efficiency in MSME sector, and some of the key energy efficiency measures which we widely see getting implemented, and then what are the upcoming trends or the focus areas for MSME where they can leverage to improve energy efficiency in cost-effective manner. Over to you, Akshay.
Thank you, Atik. Thanks, Shubhangi. And Atik, thank you for setting up the context. I think, just a second. Can I have? Yeah, thank you. So as Atik mentioned, the intention of my presentation would be to sort of share with you, one, how is energy efficiency a cost-saving enabler and also an enabler to reduce environmental impacts? But more importantly, how is energy efficiency a tool to drive competitiveness in your organization? That will be the intention of my presentation. Before that, just to set out the background quickly, I think energy efficiency can be defined as the optimal utilization of energy without any trade-offs in either the smoother operations or the safety during the operation itself. So it is paramount that while we adopt any energy efficiency, it cannot come at the cost of, you know, operator discomfort or safety being at a risk. But having said that, energy efficiency, as was mentioned earlier, is as a concept, one, it is cross-sectoral. Second, it clearly has demonstrated huge benefits when it comes to economically. That is, by employing or adopting energy efficiency initiatives, there are definitely cost savings that will accrue. But more importantly, what the important thing that I want to drive out here is that there are close to 40 million MSME units in our country. And if you look at it from a broader perspective, and if we say that if each of those units will work towards reducing their energy consumption by, say, 2 units, then we're talking about 80 million units of energy consumption being avoided. And subsequently, this 80 million units of reduction in energy consumption translates to significant amount of coal burning reduction inside the thermal power stations, which will have a great impact when it comes to the emissions. We can avoid a whole lot of emissions from our power plants. So I think energy efficiency, therefore, one, it is the incremental step. It is the initial step that any MSME can undertake. It not only gives benefits economically to that MSME unit, it also has a larger environmental impact, on a national level. And having said that, energy efficiency is not a new concept. Energy efficiency is something which is quite mature, be it both a large industry or MSMEs. Energy efficiency is pretty well understood. But the only thing that might differentiate is the fact that maybe in large industries or some other units who have explored energy efficiency, but they've gone, into the extensive analysis or extensive adoption of energy efficiency inside their own premises. Whereas in some small scale or micro scale units, energy efficiency is done selectively. It is not done as a part of the system. But despite of all this, one thing that I would like to highlight is the fact that energy efficiency is not a one-time activity. It cannot be a one-time activity. It is always a continual activity. What I mean by that is, for any operation which is energy efficient at this point in time, by default, when the operations, with the time passing by, the operations through wear and tear and whatnot, will definitely, the efficiency of the systems will start to come down. And therefore, it becomes paramount that the systems, the organizations ensure that the energy performance level that they had at the start remain the same or even improve from what they had at the start, right? Therefore, energy efficiency cannot just be a one-time activity where we just answer to a certain compliances or maybe to a third party which is asking for it, but rather imbibe it as a part of our system and make it a continual process. Now, having understood the benefits of energy efficiency, I mean, and I think that is pretty much demonstrated and it is clear. The next question is, therefore, that for MSMEs out there who are listening to us right now, or the stakeholders who are interacting with the MSMEs, the question would be, what should be the approach towards energy efficiency? How can we adopt energy efficiency? So we basically bring it down to three-pronged approach. The first one of that is capacity utilization. What do we mean by that? Basically, when we design a system, it should be designed in such a way that whatever we generate is equivalent to whatever we want to consume at the process end. A good example of that, if I have to take, would be, say, a compressor, which I think would be fairly understood across all the sectors. just take an example of a compressor, an air compressor, which is designed for 300 cubic foot per minute of airflow, that is CFM. And the process where which it is connected to requires only 200 CFM of air. Now, what happens in this case is there is significantly a mismatch between a generation end and the consumer end, and the compressor is clearly oversized. We might, you know, the operations will not stop. Compressor will keep on generating the air, process will get its due air, and the operation will not stop. But what happens to the energy consumption? Basically, because of this oversizing, the compressor will run for 30%, 40% of its time on unload condition. What do we mean by unload condition? The compressor will be consuming electricity, but will not be delivering any output. It will not be delivering any air. So from the energy point of view, the MSME has not saved anything. They have put up a compressor which is of higher capacity. Their operations are working well. Everything is fine. But on the, you know, on their energy conservation front, they're not able to save anything because they're still, the money is still draining out, or the energy is still being drained out or during the unload power. So it is very important that capacity utilization is the first step. If we go back to our offices or our own factories, we need to see how much is the mismatch between what we have put in and what we are operating in. An easier example of that could be, I think, which all of you will corroborate or understand well, is let's take a case of, say, an office space where there are four cubicles, and we enter in the office space, there are four people working in those cubicles, but they have 30 light fixtures above them. The question, therefore, is, do we really need 30 light fixtures for four people? Is the lumens that we are giving out, is it really for that, do we really need 30 light fixtures, or can we have just 10? So I think this is what we mean by capacity utilization. So if there is an opportunity to optimize our capacity and make them run at their optimal capacity, that will be the first step. The second step is, in case we are not able to do that, we come down to fine tuning. What do we mean by fine tuning? Fine tuning is basically doing certain incremental changes to your own systems or your own equipments. Referring again to the compressor example, now there is a scenario where my process needs, say, 100 CFM of air at 5 kg pressure. But at my generation end, that is my compressor, it is delivering 100 CFM of air, but at 7 kg pressure, because you have kept the setting like that. Now, what is happening is, first, we need to see why there is this big difference in the pressure. Is there a natural pressure drop from the generation to the user? Is actually the pressure coming down because of the pipeline bends or the friction in the pipes? Therefore, there is this drop in the pressure. If that is the case, we need to fix it, streamline it, and reduce our generation pressure. If not, and in most cases, what we have seen is that the generation pressure is kept at 7 kg because that is how it came from the OEM. Whereas we also realize that at the process end, our equipments cannot run at 7 kg. They need 5 kg pressure for them to operate. So what we do is we install PRVs, that is pressure regulating valves. Now, by doing that, what we are doing again is we are definitely saving our equipment at the consumer end. We are saving our process equipments. We are also ensuring that operations are smoother. But what is happening to the energy? Are we saving energy in this? No. Is there an opportunity to save energy? Absolutely, yes. How? The 7 kg pressure, instead of artificially reducing it with pressure regulating valves and bringing it down to 5 kg, why can't we go to the generation side itself, reduce the generation pressure just by changing the tap setting from 7 to 5 or closer to 5, keeping certain margins? By doing that, what we will essentially do is we will save a huge lot of energy, because at the generation end, now the compressor will only be running to generate a lower pressure air. Therefore, there will be a huge substantial saving, right? So that is our second step. So I hope these two things are clear. So if, as an MSME enterprise, you want to go back to your factory, these are the two approaches initially that you need to take. One, analyze your own assets, see what is their actual design capacity versus what they're actually running for. And if there's a substantial mismatch, can we optimally load them? If not, can we fine tune our systems? Can we further, try to do certain incremental changes, maybe put up a VFD and optimize the compressed air system or any other system for that matter? That then, if both of these are not happening, and in some cases what might happen is the technology has served its lifetime. Technology is already 20, 25 years old. So we can't expect a very high levels of energy efficiency from the technology. So therefore, time has come for us to replace the technology and put up the energy efficiency technology. The important point here to note is while we have that, again, let's take an example of a compressor. We have an old reciprocating compressor in place, which is already 25 years plus. Now that compressor is giving us the air, which is needed by the process. So from the production point of view, we are seeing that there is no stoppage. Everything is running fine. But the huge loss that we have is by continuously running that compressor, you know, beyond its lifetime at a very low energy efficient levels, we are actually draining out our own money. There are far better efficient technologies available in the market. They might cost us slightly higher upfront. There might be a capital outlay that you'll have to shell out. But the operation and the maintenance cost, if you account for the next 20 years, the savings that you'll accrue will far outweigh, as was mentioned earlier. So I think these are decisions to be taken at the management level, at the senior management level, at the operation level. Out of the three approaches, of course, technology upgradation is the last approach. But the first thing is, we need to first see whatever assets we have in place, whether they are, their capacity is properly utilized. Number two, if not, can we fine-tune them by, you know, putting up certain other, changing certain settings, putting up new other technologies like VFDs, or et cetera, et cetera. If not, if all of this is out of the window, then can we go for technology upgradation overall? So these are the three-pronged approach. I hope it is much clearer for all of you. And all of you, once you go back to your factories or your premises, you can try to undertake with this lens. So basically, now approach is clear to us, I hope. The next step is, we have also segregated and bucketed them in various different categories. For example, when it comes to an MSME, a typical MSME cross-sectorally, these are the five buckets that we talk about: electrical, thermal, compressed air pumping, and process applications. So what are the energy efficient opportunities for improvement in all of these buckets? Important point to note here is that, of course, I am going to list out the opportunities for improvement under each of these buckets. In the paucity of time, I'll not be in a position to explain each one of them because they are in itself a topic to discuss. But the intention here is that while you have the access to our slides and the presentation, you'll also get the access to all these important opportunities for improvement for you to then see and explore whether you have already accessed and explored all of these technologies at your own facilities, or whether there is some more potential which you can see from the list that you can undertake. Starting with electrical, of course, you can look at transformer loading. We should see whether the transformers are optimally loaded. They should not be either overloaded or underloaded. Power factor, we see is a big, big opportunity, because right now many MSMEs are paying huge penalties because of maintaining low power factors. Voltage optimization is the other. Our motors that we have in line, motors, we have, you know, what happens is motors fail, we rewind them, we again put them in. But there is a limit to which we can rewind and put it again, because for after every rewinding that we do, these rewounded motors are not efficient. They cannot be of the same efficiency levels. So I think we should have an SOP in place where if we are driving energy efficiency, that we cannot use a rewounded motors after, say, one time or two times. And also, on the other hand, we should also see what standard of motors are we using. Right now, there might be IE1, IE2 motors in place. That is what we also see. But there are already IE4 and IE5 standard motors which are available in the market, which are far more efficient. So, I mean, these are some of the aspects in electrical that you can look at. And similarly, in pumps, for example, if you remember the approach that I mentioned, first of all, optimum design. If you have to install a new pump, we need to know what is the actual process requirement and accordingly try to, you know, design the pump and the pumping layout in such a way that it matches the actual requirement. And more importantly, this is another thing that we see, that sometimes the pumps that we sort of procure, they are, their design efficiencies are itself very, very low. They are in the tune of 50%, 60%. So you cannot expect a much larger efficiency out of it. So while procuring itself, we also need to be very mindful of the fact that the pumps that we are getting in have to be of higher efficiencies. And then if you remember the other aspect of fine tuning, which is installing VFD, doing hydrophobic coating, to improve incrementally improve the energy performance. Likewise, in compressed air, arresting leakages. I think very important point which we see in the compressed air network in MSMEs. Of course, the piping network is not significant. It is not as high as, say, any large industry. But having said that, the leakages are in the tune of 20%, 25%. So basically what you're doing is compressor is, you know, generating compressed air, and 25% of it is going to leakages alone. So I think it is very important to remember that, you know, however, the air is free, but compressed air is not free. You are putting in money to generate that compressed air. So it is also very important that our workers and our operators are enabled to understand what are the leakages in the system. You know, there should be a guidelines to them that, you know, a simple leak detection through sound, if they can do it, and they can put a tag on the pipeline so that whenever there is an opportunity to fix it, they can always do it. So maybe or set up two volunteers only looking at compressor leakage if that is a big problem, in terms of identifying wherever the leakages are happening. And if the leakages are very persistent, then that means that there is, you know, we might have to change the pipeline itself. The pipeline has, of course, it is time for us to change it. So I think this is, with respect to leakages, something where it does not require huge investment. It only requires a concerted effort to optimally run our compressors. Second bit is, as I mentioned, optimizing a generation pressure, putting a VFD to have the consumption and the generation match make, and then waste heat recovery from compressors. The heat that is being drained out right now, can we utilize it in the system? And there are technology suppliers out there who are giving solutions for it. So these are some of the opportunities that you can explore when it comes to electrical pumps and compressors. And similarly, when it comes to boiler and steam distribution.
Akshay, sorry to interrupt, but can you please try to conclude in 2 to 3 minutes, please? Thank you.
Sure, Adik. So coming to the boilers and steam distribution, so we are talking about, say, radiation losses and the boiler efficiencies, waste heat recoveries, multi-stage boilers. So again, not going into all of this, of course, as I said, it would require an intensive discussion, but it is out there. You can always look at this list and try to see what all of you can sort of try to explore. Beyond this, I wanted to spend just a minute on this particularly is the fact that energy efficiency beyond these opportunities for improvement also have what are the other drivers? Number one, leveraging digitalization for energy efficiency. That is, you know, adopting IoT-based solutions, especially to start with for monitoring and metering systems. Right now, the MSMEs don't have any meters in place. They do not know what their equipments are generating, what they are consuming rather, and there is no asset performance monitoring which is being done. So this is one area where you can have first each in-depth analysis of your energy consumption, but more importantly, introduce IoT layer into your factories. Second is fostering innovation. I discussed about it in terms of process and technology. Third is, in case where you have certain financial constraints, can we look at innovative implementation model, which will make the implementation far easier? I'll cover one of them if the time permits. I'll just try to do that. And the last bit which I wanted to focus on more was that if you are an energy efficiency unit and you want to become a world-class energy efficiency unit, it cannot happen simply by doing intermittent audits or compliances. Then there is a need to build a system in place, a robust system for energy efficiency, make energy efficiency a core strategic element, and therefore drive decisions based on it. One way of doing it is through ISO 50001, which is a voluntary standard which guides the MSMEs on improving their energy performance. Basically, by doing this process, some of the key aspects, of course, of this energy ISO 50001 are that it enables top management commitment. You have policy directives coming in through this, policy directives concerning, say, procurement decisions. For any ACs that I will buy, it will be 5-star labeled or no less, right? For any ceiling fan that it will buy, will be BLDC ceiling fan. So it will be a policy directive, right, with the top leadership involved. Second, it will help you set the baseline. It will help you measure and monitor most of your equipment, set you the baseline, develop an energy action plan. It will also help you develop key indicators that you'll have to measure and monitor. And of course, in the whole process, the important thing is the awareness level, the awareness to the entire, all the employees, right, from top leadership to the workers. All of them will be aware of the concept of energy efficiency and the need for energy efficiency overall. So in the end, I think it was very important that I discuss, this is my last slide, I'll just discuss this model with all of you, because I think just to share an insight, last year we did a quick survey with our industry members just to understand that what was their post-COVID scenario, how they were looking at recovering from it, and what was the implication on energy efficiency. what they said, it was very interesting to note that energy efficiency still remains a top priority because it clearly is makes them more competitive, gives them that enables them to save their energy costs. But more importantly, what they said is financial crunch is, of course, a prevalent issue at this time. And therefore, more than 70% of them said they'll be more than willing to explore ESCO model. Now, what is ESCO model? ESCO stands for Energy Service Companies. Now, in a traditional arrangement, if any MSME wants a technology, they will go to the technology supplier and buy the technology and pay for it. But in the ESCO system, what will happen is there is an ESCO which will put up the technology at the client facility, and they will put up the technology at their own cost. So both the technical risk as well as financial risk is being taken care of by the ESCO themselves. All the operation and maintenance during the part of the contract will be taken care of by ESCO. So what they only do is they have the ESPC signed, or EPC, which is energy performance contract, with the client. As per the energy performance contract, the ESCO says that the technology that I will put in your facility will result in 5% or 10% or whatever savings each month. And the only thing that they have to do is that after each month, whatever they save, they'll have to pay a certain share of that savings back to the ESCO. And this is how ESCO generates their own money and recovers its own cost. And after maybe a period of 2 or 3 years till they have recovered their money, then they go back. The asset remains with the client, and the client avails the benefit. See, the value add here is, if there is a client who is either skeptical of the technology, or if there is a client who is having financial crunch, ESCOs are a good tool. A tool because ESCOs are a medium where they can come in and bring in their technology, take the technology risk, demonstrate the savings to you. So you as a client will not have to pay anything upfront. The only payment that you do is out of your savings. That is also a percentage of that you'll have to share to the ESCO. So of course, ESCO has its own challenges, but this is one model which we feel going forward in promoting energy efficiency has to play a larger role. With this, I will conclude my presentation. Of course, if there are any questions, I'm sure once we share the slides, the list of technologies that you see, if you have any questions on it, we'll be there to answer you and help you out with it. Also, if you want to explore ESCO models or any other models and want more information, you have my contact details. Thank you once again. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Akshay. I guess we have a few poll questions based on Akshay's presentation. So I will request WRI team to take it forward here.
Yeah. Hi, this is Tejaswini here from WRI. I'll be launching the first poll question. And you'll have about 30 seconds to answer this. Akshay, do you want to briefly just discuss this?
Yeah, the answer? Yes. I mean, sure. Yes, I think it is quite evident that the participants are very well aware of the factor of life cycle cost, which is basically, it accounts for both your initial cost as well as operation and maintenance cost. I think for any procurement decision henceforth, this is one aspect, especially when it comes to energy efficiency, that has to be considered, and it is very well corroborated by the poll survey as well.
Thank
you. We can move on to the next. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I'll be launching the next one. Again, you'll have around 30 seconds to answer this question as well.
I think very encouraging to note that at least everybody has they have these unexplored areas, especially compressors, electrical. And in fact, I think our panel today, we have a panelist on compressors as well. So it will be interesting to also listen from them. Well, okay, it's quite evident. I think this also corroborates what I was talking about in the last slide. There are some cases where upfront capital outlay is preferred, but ESCO performance contracting, again, more than 70% of them. So I think this sort of indicates that ESCO can be the next step to look at all of these facilities. And therefore, if you need any of the information more on ESCO performance contracting and, of course, about the ESCOs, you guys can reach out to us and we'll be there to help you out. Thank you.
Over to you, Atik.
Thank you, Akshay and Shivangini, for conducting the polls. Now we will move to the next presentation from consultant organization to the OEM. So Godrej and Boyce Manufacturing have been undertaking many initiatives at their plant, at their appliances division or other manufacturing facilities. But in addition to that, we see that Godrej have been now been working with their value chain, because considering their engineering operations, they have to rely a lot on the supply chain. And it is an important part of your GHG emissions also, which are scope 3 emissions. So we have with us Mr. Amol Magdam from Godrej & Boyce, who is an associate chief manager, and he will be sharing the experiences on how they have accelerated the energy efficiency in their vendor and their value chain, and what has been the key learnings from that. So over to you, Mr. Amol, for the presentation. Thank you. Mr. Amol, I guess you are on mute. You need to unmute yourself and then speak. Just a moment. Varun, can you unmute Mr. Amol, please? He's self-muted at his phone.
Yes, yeah. Am I audible now?
Yes, Mr. Amol, you can. You are clear, sir.
So thank you, Atik. Thank you for giving us an opportunity to present our approach on how we have improved energy efficiency in the entire supply chain. So good afternoon, everyone. Next slide. So before going to the main topic of the presentation, I would like to give you a brief on how whole journey of transforming Shirwal factory and its supply chain was started. You all know the CII cluster movement was started way back in 1998 by Professor Suda. For almost a decade, this movement was limited to the auto industry. In 2010, CII, under the mentorship of Mr. C. Narasimhan, initiated first hybrid cluster for the industries from varied sectors in and around Pune. Godrej Shirwal was the first Godrej and Boyce plant to join it. During cluster journey of 2 years, Godrej Appliances Shirwal plant outperformed on all the deliverables among the participants and become the benchmark amongst the group as well as within the Godrej and Boyce plant. So you can say this is the rehabilitation program for the Godrej Appliances Shirwal plant wherein we have outperformed on all the deliverables. Next slide. So as we all know, the strength of chain is the strength of its weakest link. Keeping that in mind, our top management come with the approach that why not we should extend this initiative learnings to our suppliers. So we decided to go and form the clusters for suppliers, wherein we can implement the lean and green manufacturing initiatives, extend these initiatives to our suppliers to strengthen the entire value chain. Next slide. So what is the uniqueness and guiding principles of the cluster program? Talking about the uniqueness, the Godrej didn't hire the external consultant. Instead, our top management shown confidence in its own employees and shouldered this responsibility to young enthusiasts who were instrumental in cluster journey at Godrej. A separate vertical called supplier improvement team was formed, who took care of implementation of cluster initiatives as well as Greenco implementation at SME supplier partners. The single best ideology to drive cluster is treating suppliers as an extension of our own manufacturing facility. Coming together, learning together, practicing together, and progressing together is the philosophy while braving the journey towards excellence. Next. For effective strategy implementation, a supporting organization structure is essential. The structure was created depending upon the critical activities to be carried out and critical role and responsibilities to be handled. As discussed in the previous slide, a separate vertical called supplier improvement team was created as a link between supplier and Godrej. Supplier improvement team members are the counselors for the Godrej supplier cluster. In order to drive cultural change, a key person from the supplier organization must be responsible. Cluster CEO is the top authority to drive cluster supplier plan, who take executive decisions independently. Next. For the Godrej supplier cluster program, a new roadmap was designed to suit the local SME supplier, with emphasis on handholding apart from training and development of their employees. Initially, the roadmap comprises of 4 modules, that is 5 years, My Machine, Quality and Productivity Improvement. Subsequently, Godrej added a new module called as a Green Practices. So this is the actual game changer, which we realized right at the start, when even CI has not launched the Greenco program for SME supplier partners. Next. So the first cluster we rolled out in January 13, with one group at Shirwal and 2 groups at Mohali plant. So coming to the methodology, next slide. This slide shows our methodology of energy efficiency improvement in value chain. So as Akshay has already explained few of the activities that we need to go ahead in order to improve energy efficiency. So we do not have to reinvent the wheel, because CII has already done a good work and they already set how we can improve energy efficiency, water conservation. So all 8 modules, CII has done a good work and they already set the tone. Just we have to adapt this methodology and to go ahead to have energy efficiency improvement across the supply chain. So we adopted the CII approach. That is, we considered all the credits that are included in the energy efficiency module, and we tried to implement those initiatives before our suppliers could go for Greenco certification. Next. Now, coming to the first step, that is the commitment. The top management support is a key requirement for success of energy efficiency improvement program. Top management should give energy efficiency equal importance in their corporate objectives as manpower, raw materials, production and sales. So the importance has to be given to the energy efficiency. We have divided this commitment into 4-5 different aspects. That is, first vision, that is green vision, green policy, target setting, financial allocation and review mechanism. We will have a detail from the subsequent slide. Next slide. So a green vision and green policy are the foundation of company's sustainability efforts. It provides the organization and stakeholders with an understanding of what important most important and what your company can do to protect the natural world and become more socially responsible. So this slide gives the green vision set by one of our suppliers during their GreenCo journey and during their cluster journey. So they have considered all the aspects, wherein the highlighted portion is for energy conservation, wherein they have took a target of 40% reduction in energy consumption by 2023. Next. All our suppliers have released their green policies, which includes the energy efficiency, water, waste management, and rest of the parameters of GreenCo during their journey through supplier cluster program. So this has set the tone for them to work on. Next slide. Target setting is based on green vision guidelines, green policy, energy audit observations, and benchmarking. So setting goal is the first step in turning invisible to visible. So the target setting was done on based on these four parameters. Next. Once we are done with the target setting, now it's time to prepare action plan and financial allocation for every energy efficiency improvement project. Suppliers started allocating budgets in addition to CAPEX expenditure at the start of the year. The single most ideology is resource waiting for ideas, not the ideas waiting for resources. Next. Reviews are important to recognize the past performance, monitor status of the projects which are in progress, and discuss future targets and objectives. So we have two types of reviews. One that is during cluster program, we have monthly review meeting that happens to that took place at one of the suppliers, wherein that supplier presents their efforts put in for the month and they showcase their presentation. So the second type of review that happens internally at the supplier places, where they review their energy performance on monthly basis with their team. Next. Total employee involvement builds a work culture of collaborative workforce for better growth and success of organization. To ensure this PEI, we developed four-pronged strategy, that is communication, event celebration, employee participation, and reward and recognition. Next. The training and capacity building was important at supplier end, since all our SME supplier partners, as the poll has requested, poll survey, wherein we had a question that what is the biggest problem with the SMEs, that why they are not going for green code. That is, in order to create the awareness among the supply chain, we decided to have training and capacity building at supplier end. The term training and capacity building are sometimes confused. Well, this difference between the training and capacity development. Training is just one element of capacity building. It usually focuses on providing skill for a specific problem. Capacity development encompasses on a whole range of activities designed to empower the individuals. That's what we've done through supplier cluster program, that is handholding program. Next. We have not only limited our suppliers to our trainings and awareness programs, we encourage them to participate into various CII events such as GreenCo Summit, Green Concave, National Competitive and Cluster Summit, and ask them to present their case studies for the cross-learning. That helps them a lot to gain the knowledge on green technologies, green initiatives that the rest of the world is taking care of, and they also presented their case studies to the others. Next. The energy management team was formed to take care of energy efficiency improvement program within the organization. And we had, as Akshay told, that we try to divide this as the electrical energy, renewable energy, and thermal energy. We took care of all these things right at the time of formulation of energy management team and supplier end. And role and responsibilities were defined based on their ability. Next. Till now, whatever we have seen is just the homework by the top management to get everything in place. The work that is middle management and the lower management has to perform that it starts from here. That is energy monitoring system. This we are divided into three parts, that is energy metering, daily variance analysis, and corrective action on deviations. Next. So we, as we all know, you cannot improve what you don't measure. In order to have machine-wise and section-wise energy monitoring, we installed energy meters. That during cluster program, these energy meters were installed at supplier's end to monitor the energy consumption, that is section-wise and machine-wise. We ensured that 80% of the energy is monitored through energy meters right at the cluster implementation program. Next, few of our suppliers with high energy intensive units have gone ahead and installed cloud-based energy monitoring software to get real-time data. This provides data on energy consumption, voltage, current, department-wise consumption, machine-wise consumption. This is all the real-time data that they can have look at any time. Next. Since the energy meters were installed, here we applied 80-20 rule, wherein the high energy intensive units were being monitored on daily basis for variance analysis. Next. After identifying any variance, the analysis of deviation was important. So analysis was done through VIVA analysis to identify the root cause. Next. Based on the analysis, the action plan was derived and actions taken, correct actions were taken to reduce or improve energy efficiency, reduce energy consumption or improve energy efficiency. These are some of the glimpses what suppliers have done to improve the energy efficiency, depending upon the daily variance analysis.
Mr. Amol, please conclude in 2 minutes. You have 2 minutes remaining, sir. That's right.
Yes. Energy efficiency improvement measures, such as we started adopted micro-level methodology, where energy input and output, there are two types of losses, that is unavoidable and avoidable losses. Our focus was to quantify the losses, to concentrate on avoidable losses, identify ways and means for reduction and implementation. Next slide. Energy efficiency improvement measures. I think I can skip this 4 slides because Akshay has already given emphasis on these slides, that is lighting and electrical systems, what approach we have adopted to improve energy efficiency on these parameters. Next slide. Compressed air, Akshay has already emphasized on this. Next, pumps and blowers, already been taken care of by Akshay. Next, boilers and furnaces. So the next, after doing all these things, there is further scope to improve. That we took care through benchmarking. Since the benchmarking data for SME suppliers were, for most of the suppliers was not available, so we asked them to go for process-wise benchmarking, machine-wise benchmarking, so that they can improve the machines which are lagging behind. Next. Since all our suppliers were ready during cluster program, they just have to enroll themselves for Greenko certification. The Greenko SME rollout, first rollout was took place at Sherwal plant on February 16. We were the first in India to launch Greenko for SME supplier partners. So three of our suppliers enrolled themselves for Greenko certification in first phase, wherein two of our suppliers got platinum certification and one supplier got gold certification. Next. The scaling up, then we decided to scale up this cluster program as well as Greenko certification for SME supplier partners. Till now, 71 supplier partners have undergone supplier cluster program and 69 suppliers of Godrej appliances are Greenko certified. This is the maximum number of Greenko certification for any OEM in India. I can proudly say that. Next. Talking about the benefits, 29% reduction in energy consumption we have achieved across the supply chain. Thank you.
Thank you, Amol sir, for highlighting the initiatives by Godrej Appliances for supplier energy efficiency program, sir. I just wanted to share, sir, that for the previous two training programs which you had as part of this training series, your two vendors from SAG Glass and Kotale presented on variety of initiatives which they have undertaken to reduce GHG emissions also, sir. So many congratulations to you, sir. 2% reduction in the value chain energy consumption is like, though the 2% looks less, but if we talk about across the value chain, then I'm sure the numbers will be like a lot of energy savings will be there, sir. So many congratulations to you, sir. I will request participants to please keep putting the questions in the questions or chat window so that the speakers can provide you with the necessary clarifications or solutions to your questions. Now moving to the next presentation, from OEM, now we will listen from the MSME perspective on what are the opportunities for energy efficiency. We have with us Mr. Suresh Manoharan, who is the Executive Director at Vascular Solutions, which is a dyeing company. And also, if we see, they have implemented many measures to reduce their thermal energy consumption, because if I talk about dye operation in textile sector, it is a very energy intensive process. And I can probably say that Vascular Solutions, one proposal which they have implemented with Bosch Energy Limited, you will not find even in the large industry. So we look forward to Mr. Suresh's presentation on his experience of implementing energy efficiency measures and what were the challenges he faced in implementation. Over to you, Suresh, sir, for sharing your experience. Thank you.
Thanks, Arun. Thanks, CAA and WR India for giving an opportunity for sharing our experience of what we have done in our dye house. This is just a brief intro about our dye house. We have about a capacity of 6,500 kgs per day of dyeing knitted fabric. And we are in operation for last 13 years, and we fall under the MSME small category. And our dye house is located in an industrial estate, which is supported by the Tamil Nadu state government. Varun, can I take control of the screen? It's like a... Is it so that I can move the slides by myself?
You have control, Mr. Manoharan. Please go ahead.
Okay, right, thank you. Because I'm not able to move to the next slide. Can you just switch down?
You can just use your arrow keys or click on the screen. You should be able to move.
All right, click on the screen. Okay. Okay. As I am coming from a textile industry, or basically the fashion industry, in the entire textile supply chain, without textile dyeing, there is no value addition. Otherwise, you will be seeing a plain, because natural cotton is dull yellow in color. But if you see any thing which we wear, starting from myself to yourself and all around you, everything is in different colors because of the textile dyeing. But there are two major issues which we see in the textile dyeing. One is which is promoted very heavily even today in social media, etc., is high water consumption. So in the textile dyeing part, and which is resulting in high effluent generation, and there is a high energy consumption that is involved in the production process. So how are we handling it? So as far as the effluent is concerned, our factory comes under a zero liquid discharge scheme. That means we don't discharge any liquid effluent, not in a single drop of liquid effluent, neither inside the factory nor outside the factory into any river body or etc. The entire effluent that is generated is treated, recovered and reused. So in the recovery process, we get about 90% of recovery, 10% is lost due to natural evaporation, etc. So our freshwater requirement has come down by 90%. So we use only 10% of freshwater for our production top up. So remaining 90% is from the effluent that is generated. So this takes care of both the issues. One, handling of the effluent, and the handling of the freshwater requirement. So coming to this sessions, that is the energy efficiency, textile dyeing requires a lot of huge energy consumption, both in terms of thermal energy and electrical energy. So my presentation here is to focus on the thermal energy. The textile dyeing happens in a different, it is not a single process. It takes in maybe about 8 steps to 14 steps, depending on the color, depending on the fabric you want to dye, etc. So in our dyeing process, typically we heat the fresh water that comes in maybe at 30 degree centigrade to temperature varying from 60 degree all the way up to 120 degree, depending on which fabric. For example, polyester we do dyeing at 120 degree and normal cotton we do at 80, 85. So basically our heating range is from 30 degree fresh water all the way up to 60 degree to 120 degree. And once our dyeing process is over, we cool them down to 80 degree, between 60 to 80 degree, and drain the water. So the hot effluent, takes away the heat energy along with it. So we plan on implementing a heat recovery system, so which will help in both these aspects. So what we have done is, we like to recover the waste heat from three different sources. As I said, the wastewater or the textile effluent which is being drained from the machine is being let out anywhere between 60 to 80 degrees. So we like to recover the heat from there. And also I showed you that we heat all the way up to 120 degrees, but we don't drain like that because that will affect the fabric. So we always cool from say 120 degree to 80 degree and then we drain it. So the cooling, we give it as a basically a shell and tube heat exchanger where we send a fresh water at 30 degree and cool the dye bath which is at 120 degree. So we like to recover the heat from that cooling process also. And the third is from the boiler. Whatever the flue gas thermal loss or whatever the waste heat that is being sent out through the flue gas, we wanted to recover. So these three aspects has been integrated and put it into a single solution. So this is a kind of a pictorial representation. I think it will look a little bit complicated, but it is basically the three things. If you can see here my dyeing machine, so whatever the cooling return, using a plate heat exchanger, we are recovering the heat. So the next one is the effluent that is being drained. So we collect it and then we again through a plate heat exchanger, we recover that heat. And third economizer is at the boiler level where the at the stack, at the chimney, before it goes into the steam chimney, we recover the heat from the flue gas. So all these waste heat or which was getting lost previously are all collected into a single tank, which is about 200 KL, and we use that hot water for our production. So this entire system was designed by Bosch and designed, implemented by them. So this gives a picture of what is there physically at my factory. The one on the right side is the 200 KL tank. So the middle portion will have 60 degree hot water and the top one will have the 80 degree. And the pictures on the left side shows you the various plate heat exchangers we have put in to recover the heat from both the hot effluent and also from the cooling return process. So this is actual data which we have taken once the COVID pandemic kind of tap lockdown was released and when our, we started our production. And we wanted to test how much savings we were getting with this implementation and without implementation. What we have done is like we did an alternate week test. So 1 week, because typically our dye houses runs from Monday to Saturday. So we took that as one production. And because in the weekends we do the boiler cleaning. So we took, we ran the system or the production with Bosch implemented weight recovery. The next week we switched off the Bosch system. The third week again we ran it, and fourth week we again switched off just to see how the variation is. So our savings was ranging from 22.7% to 26.5% because our production is not standard, because depending on the what our customer requires, we will be dealing with different fabrics, different colors. So we, the kind of production which we do in week one may not be exactly matching with week two or week three. So we are taking an average across 4 weeks. So the, on an average, we were able to see there was a 24% reduction in the fuel, which is specifically consumed at the production level. So I had two boilers. The first row shows the steam production at combination of those two boilers, 310 boiler and 210 boiler. And the second one shows me the total wood consumption in those two boilers. The third row shows the specific fuel consumption. And fourth row is the steam consumed for processing, because the steam that is generated from these two boilers are used in two categories. One is at the production house, and the second one is for the zero liquid discharge scheme at our ETP. So here we focus only on the production. So the fourth row is out of the total steam produced that is shown at the fourth row or first row. The fourth row shows how much is consumed for the production, which is roughly about 1/3. And using the specific fuel consumption, we theoretically consumed how much wood is consumed for production, and what is the amount of fabric processed in that week. And we finally arrived at the wood consumed per kg of fabric. So with Bosch system, we were using about 1.05 kg of firewood for every kg of fabric we dyed. Without Bosch system, it was 1.362 all the way up to 1.39. So this is our practical data which we used. And we have repeated the study even last month also. The results were more or less the same. So when we go into the economics, so average wood consumption for processing area alone was about 7,000 kgs per day. And we were looking at a fuel savings based on our practical measurements is 24%. So wood savings per day is 1,680 kgs. And our purchase cost of firewood is about, an average is 4.9 rupees per kg of firewood. So per day, we are saving about 8,200 rupees. Conservatively, I have shown you we are operating only 290 days in a year, so about 24 lakhs is the annual savings. And the total investment for this entire waste heat recovery from three sources, one is the effluent, cooling return, and flue gas is 85 lakhs. So the return of investment calculation is 3.5 years. This is on a theoretical basis, but what we have done as an agreement with Bosch is like, instead of giving all the savings as a repayment, we have structured our finance such way that 70% of the savings goes towards the repayment of the capital investment and the interest, and 30% is to improve our own cash flow, because we need to have some better cash flow because of these savings. So we have structured our finance over a 5-year period. So within 5-year period, I will be repaying the capital, I will be repaying the interest. At the same time, for 5 years, I will be getting 30% of the savings as a positive cash flow into my system. So from the 5th year or whatever the savings that comes, it is 100% it will to our bottom line. And if you can see this, as I said, my turnover is about 25 crores, 23 to 25 crores per annum. So this 24 lakhs is direct 1% improvement in my bottom line. So which is very significant savings.
Mr. Suresh, we'll request you to conclude in next 2 minutes, sir.
So our what we have seen is the benefits is we have seen a 24% result reduction in the steam consumption, but we had other benefits like a low temperature going into the effluent helps us to save the treatment cost over there. And because of hot water ready at the machine, our peak load from the boiler is reduced, so which further enhanced the boiler performance. Out of two boilers, we have even moved 1 2-ton boiler into a standby mode. So only 3-ton boiler we are using. These are the benefits we have seen. So we have done various aspects. So we are in the process of getting the, we have initiated it. So we are going for the CAA Green Co certification. And I have just two more slides. I'm going to repeat what Akshay said from a practical point of view. There are two things for in a MSME which I see around the colleagues or other investors in my area is people are not investing in utility monitoring equipment. So whatever savings I am saying, which is all based on real-time data, is because we have equipments to measure it, like the steam flow meters. We have used 5 steam flow meters to find out exactly what is the steam generated in each place and how much is utilized in different places, what are the weighing scales, energy meters. Because even people like when CAA Green Co team comes, if an unit doesn't have a steam flow meter or a weighing scale, even to find out a boiler efficiency that is happening right now is very difficult. So they can't help you to improve it. So please invest in energy monitoring equipment. And the next one and the last slide is, please invest in IoT. So because all these energy equipments, like whether it could be energy meter or a steam flow meter or a running hour meter, nothing can be manually maintained. You can't ask your person to record a reading every 1 hour. There is a fatigue sets in. They don't do it. So if you can see, we are from an iDataTech software, we have installed an IoT based system which records everything on a minute by minute value. So you can put all these things in either vendor cloud or your own private cloud. So without an real-time data acquisition and analytics, you will not be able to pinpoint your return of investment. So these are my things for the MSME industries who are listening to it. Please invest on equipments. Please invest on IoT-based monitoring systems or real-time data acquisition and analytics. So with this, I conclude my presentation. Thanks, CA and WRI once again.
Thank you, Mr. Suresh, for your sharing your experience in terms of energy efficiency implementation at your unit. And specifically, you mentioned about how energy efficiency measures are helping you to improve your cash flow. This is the main thing which every MSME, if they start seeing it, then definitely we will see more and more energy efficiency measures getting implemented in various small and medium enterprises. And also the last point which you mentioned, that every time in MSME, we cannot expect our employees to do the manual entry for the different fuel consumption, electricity consumption. And that's why it is more important for an MSME to invest in IoT solutions also. And we will see some examples from our technology suppliers who will be sharing their experience and solutions offering for MSME sector also. Thank you, Suresh sir, for your time. And we will move now next to the next presenter from WRI, Ms. Kachwa. So she is heading the leading the energy group at WRI India as a manager, and she will be sharing some experiences of WRI India and implementation of energy efficiency projects in some of the clusters like Naroda, Aurangabad, and how different energy efficiency implementation model will help us to implement energy efficiency projects at much faster rate in the MSME sector. Over to you, Kajol.
Thanks, Atik, for that brief introduction. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the webinar. So this presentation is based on our experience of working with the MSME cluster, as Atik already mentioned about the working with Naroda and Aurangabad, and the supply chains of H&M, which is the fashion industry. So those were basically the garment clusters. Can I have the access to the presentation, please? Move the slides.
Yes, Kajol, you have access. Please go ahead.
Thanks. Now, so before I begin with the my presentation, I would like to throw a question on, just to sense like how many people are aware about demand aggregation, and to see like, what do you think about, or have you heard about the demand aggregation? So Jesse, I hope you are monitoring the time, because I can't really have the control on
yes,
that.
Yes, I am.
Thanks.
Just a few more seconds and yeah, here are the results.
Oh, that's interesting. Not many have heard about the demand aggregation. So I think then all yours should be open for this presentation, and we'll take you through the work that we have done in this cluster and what was our approach and methodology. And I will emphasize more on that rather on the findings and the other things, because we have already been talking about what are the different ways of reducing the energy efficiency, and how can we, you know, improve on our overall efficiency and productivity in the system. So we know, why are we talking about MSMEs? India is the second largest hub of the MSME, having 63 million of MSME in India. At about 31% are the manufacturing industries, consuming about 1/4 of the energy consumption in the industries piece, which is the highest energy consuming segment in India. So in and in past, there has been like several initiatives taken by government to support the MSMEs to reduce their energy consumption. There have been like a lot of demonstration studies in a couple of clusters to adopt the to accelerate the adoption of energy efficiency. There have been picking up like different clusters and different kind of technologies. However, there has been always been in the pockets that has been done in the past. So under this study, we looked at both scaling the adoption and being it economically feasible through the demand aggregation. The focus was reducing the energy consumption by instituting energy efficiency as well as renewable energy into the system through demand aggregation. So we worked with three different clusters here, and all the three clusters had very different kind of their working profile and the process and everything, and that gives us more confidence on this overall demand aggregation project. One was a chemical cluster in Naroda, Gujarat. The another was an automobile cluster in the Aurangabad, which was a Masia, and the last one was the H&M. Suppliers of the garment, which was spread across Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, and Maharashtra. And these we called as our anchor partner. The others were the first step was to just secure the involvement of these respective industrial associations, the Naroda Industrial Association in Ahmedabad and Marathwada Association of Small Scale Industries and Agriculture, Masia in Aurangabad. And in case of like a supply chain, the anchor partner was the H&M itself to hold together all the suppliers in this overall study. So apart from the anchor partner for regular follow-up, we had our local partner as Gujarat Clean Air Production Center, the GCPC in Naroda, and the Eco Energy Management System, EEMS, which is a local energy auditing consultant in Aurangabad. While in the H&M, we were the one who were coordinating along with all the supply chain people. So our pre-implementation process was focused on the collection of the primary data for which we collected the energy consumption to evaluate and develop the baseline for the GHG emission, because the overall goal of the project was to bring down the GHG emission as well. When we are talking about the emission, we here specifically looked at the scope 1 and scope 2 emissions, and what is the current efficiency level and what are the energy efficiency and RE efforts that has been put forward by different kind of industries and the supply chain. And on the basis of that, we developed the overall low carbon path for these industries and tried to demonstrate the proof of concept as a part of the demand aggregation study. So during the interviews with the industries, we also overtook like a few of the walkthrough energy audits, especially in case of Naroda, because the data was not available at the scale that we wanted for doing the more detailed studies. So we had to, in fact, go ahead and do the detailed energy audit studies to identify the potential energy efficiency and the RE potential, especially in these two clusters. So out of these studies, some of the identified E measures we plan to aggregate were compressed air system, cooling system automation, and waste heat recovery system only in the Naroda cluster, because that's a chemical cluster. So this is the short finding of a primary study where in Naroda, we worked with around 70 units. And they basically had higher scope 1 emission, that is their thermal energy consumption was much higher than their electrical energy consumption. And that's the reason that we went ahead for the waste heat recovery, and we tried to demonstrate some of the insulation studies and also onto the how better they can utilize their waste heat as well. In case of the Marathwada, the Masia cluster, we worked closely with 75 industries, but their mostly the consumption was onto the electrical systems, and we focused on the compressed air systems and the cooling systems, and we picked up all these systems because these are like common across all the other industries as well. And in case of the and similarly in case of supply chain also, because of the garment industries, similar kind of the pattern was studied. And apart from the energy efficiency, we also find out like how much is the overall rooftop solar potential for different kind of industries and different kind of clusters as well. So while we did demonstrate some of the EE interventions in Masia and Naroda, but the overall uptake of the aggregation was not very successful in case of both the clusters. However, in case of the H&M supply chain, because they had a common goal towards it, they were able to implement a lot of energy efficiency measures immediately after they got our report. So that this is something that we also observed, like they wanted somebody from the outside to make them aware. Sometimes they were aware about these few low-hanging fruits that are there, but once they see it on the report and once they see it from the third party coming, it kind of verifies their own findings also, that makes them push towards, you know, installing all these activities which was already in the pipeline. So although the EE interventions were very low in case of the adoption in Naroda and Masia, but we were able to demonstrate the solar rooftop study, and we were able to do the demonstration of the demand aggregation in case of the solar, which is a case study I'll take you forward ahead. But a couple of the reasons that we observed because of which the EE could not take place was definitely one which we have already been talking about, the awareness about the equipments and also awareness on the different kind of technologies that are available. And the EE sizing also varies from industries to industries, and the saving would be very varied. And plus, like when you see a solar system installed on your rooftop, you feel like there is a energy saving or there is something happening. But energy efficiency is like you cannot see it, so you feel, I don't know how I should be going forward for it. And also, there aren't any strong policies on the EE, and the M&E is also very difficult. In a couple of the cases, we also saw like when we were working in Masia, we were not able to find the compressor suppliers for the size that we were looking at. And the credit rating was another criteria that came forward while we were working with the EE supplier specifically, not in case of the RE, although. I'll take you through the case study that we had done in Naroda and Masia on the solar rooftop. So currently we have seen like most of the industries in India procure the on-site solar rooftop, solar PV system via individual contracts and do not harness the economies of scale. So this idea was to demonstrate the aggregation model and achieve the economies of scale. In this, the three key stakeholders in the process was the industrial association, the industries, who are the part of the industrial associations as well, the local consultant, and the vendor. So with the help of these, especially with the help of the industrial associations, the anchor partner, and the local consultant, we were able to sensitize the industries till the procurement of the solar PV. We conducted multiple training sessions and capacity building workshops that helped in making the industries aware about what their findings are, what kind of a vendor there will be, how post implementation there will be the issues, and how can we overcome those issues. So post during our preliminary study, we identified the potential for solar system, rooftop solar system separately in both the clusters, and separately we had the vendor discussions as well. So we actually set up a small working group comprising of basically the industries and senior industrial associations, so that there is a proper transparency in the whole process, and we get more confidence from the industries while selecting the vendors. So along with the industrial association, we developed the technical specification for the solar rooftop system, which was as per the MNRE guidelines as well. So the primary filtering for the criteria for the vendors was basically the evaluation in terms of the technology offerings, like what is the percentage of the efficiency for the inverter, what kind of a panels they are giving, and etc. And the secondary criteria for us was the what is the economics offering from these vendor in terms of like total life cycle of the total life cycle cost of the system and rate of returns. We calculated the ROI and IIR for the grid connected system, and we assisted them into finalizing the solar vendor through stakeholder consultation. By the end of this whole process, it took us about like almost a year to finalize these whole thing, like starting from the baseline collection, data collection to selection of the vendors, and then the calculations and everything, finalization of the vendor. The price finalized through our demand aggregation project for Masia cluster, which is the Aurangabad cluster, was about 33,000 per kilowatt, while for the Naroda, it was 39,000 per kilowatt. So,
2 minutes,
yeah, I'm almost on my second last slide. So, post few of the installation and to bring in more of these industries, we conducted the survey and interviews to understand their motivation for demand aggregation, the project, and how can we like overcome the project barriers. So most of them were planning to be a part of this demand aggregation based on the technical assistance that was being offered by us. And that is where we understand like people are not much aware about the different kind of technologies and how these solar panels, how to judge them and et cetera. So, and the second top reason was definitely the finances. So the cost reduction beyond the market price was something that helped motivate them to be a part of this whole demand aggregation project. Although finances in terms of going by the RESCO model or by the ESCO model was not a constraint for them. This could be a particular cluster which they were very upfront about making the investment and were very sure about it because they were also looking at the other tax benefits to it. Just on the last slide. So through our study, we learned that the technical awareness and industrial association involvement and the commitment are definitely the most influencing factor to accomplish a project, being in demand aggregation or anything. And the most important is the coordination from the local consultant who can bridge the gap between the industries and vendor technology know-how, and also developing the RFP and guiding through the whole process of selecting the vendor. So he can, the local coordinator could be an energy auditor also, or any firm whom you, any industrial association can find confident in, who can make the whole process very transparent as well. Another is the favorable policies to promote the clean energy adoption. While in case of solar, it's still present, like there are a few policies which favor the industries to take it up, while for the EE, we realize there aren't any EE policies that can actually help for the demand aggregation. So yeah, so those were our things, and yeah, I stop here, and I have one more poll at the end of it, which I'll ask Tejaswini to take forward.
Sure. So just a question. You get about 30 seconds to answer this as well. Kajal, would you like to go over the answers briefly?
Yeah, sure. Thanks. Thanks to Jaswini for putting out that poll. Yeah, bringing industries together is definitely one of the challenge. And in our case, somehow the industrial associations that we were working were quite tightly bonded together to bring in the different kind of industries that are part of these industrial associations. And it was definitely, very difficult to keep all of them engaged throughout the year, but with the regular capacity building workshop and discussions along with the vendors and putting out the MADOs and the, so after one or two installation, they put out different kind of posters and banners to all the industries about the savings, and the actual findings that came out brought more, even more people onto the board for the, so yeah, I think there are different ways where you can bring in all the kind of industries that could be a part of this program. And second, I see the pricing or the low tariff or the high installation cost. Yeah, I think with the kind of the pricing that we got for the overall is definitely one, but there are, along with the demand aggregation, a RESCO model can also be worked out if there is a potential for a good solar installation in that case. Thanks, Jaswini. I'll stop you.
Thank you. Varun, do you want to go to the next slide, please? Yeah. So as of now, we don't have any questions. So we can continue to the next speaker. Mr. Atik, it's all yours.
Thank you, Kajol, for highlighting the demand aggregation model. And though we did not see much of the success in energy efficiency, but definitely with the example which you have shared on renewable energy, the key message which is coming out is that definitely the price discovery which we talk about is less than 10 to 15% than what the market rate is for the aggregation model. So definitely in various clusters such as Ankleshwar, or if I talk about big clusters in Foundry, Kolhapur, or Belgaum, many of this scenario, for example, if we focus on particular technology and try to do a demand aggregation, then definitely the MSMEs can get a lot of benefits. And though the other activities are now coming up, like in terms of RFP and other things, but definitely as we see more and more models coming up, things will become more as business as usual. Now, moving from the experience sharing session to the technology supplier perspective, we thought like to have the innovative solutions as a presentation for this session, because MSME, we thought, will definitely be doing some of the energy efficiency activities, but there are still a lot of potential in MSME sector for IoT, artificial intelligence application, where we see that if we apply this in a normal operation, then definitely the savings which we'll be seeing or achieving will be much more. So first, we have Mr. Vinit Kulkarni from Greenovative Energy Solutions, who have extensive experience in implementation of IoT solutions in various industries. So some of the key messages or the services from Greenovative are like overall equipment efficiency monitoring, preventive condition maintenance monitoring system. So various activities have been done by Greenovative, and definitely it will be useful for MSMEs if they implement it. So, your solutions for energy efficiency for MSME sector, sir. Sir, kindly note, you will have 15 minutes, and we will have at end of the three presentations after this session, sir. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, thanks, Atik. And thank you, WRI and CII, to provide this opportunity. Can you just give me the access so that I can move my slides? Okay. So, whatever presentations I heard of in this session, everybody was more keen or emphasizing on implementation of data-based or data-driven decision-making in order to achieve the efficiency, or in order to justify what kind of measures you are taking from energy efficiency point of view, or energy saving point of view, or productivity enhancement point of view. So I'm going to briefly elaborate about what Greenovative is contributing to this whole journey of energy efficiency or energy monitoring activities. So at a high level, we provide organizations, or we help organizations in uncovering the energy intelligence. Next, please. Yeah, so the solutions what we offer are mainly aligned with Industry 4.0, which is the recent revolution happening across all types of industries, irrespective of whether they are MSMEs or large corporations, because data-driven decision-making is the key or the way ahead for organizations to be more competitive, to be more profitable. And in terms of the solutions, we have implemented energy management solutions, asset performance monitoring, overall equipment efficiency, and IIoT put together. Successfully, we have deployed it over across 200 plus facilities in India, as well as in Middle East and Africa region. Next, please. So what is the value proposition we are offering? When we look at the energy pyramid, we lie at the bottom of the pyramid, where we are providing the energy analysis part. Based on that analysis, organizations can go for energy conservation activities, they can go for energy efficiency programs or implementation, and then subsequently they can use renewable energy sources as well as a part of their management practices. So how do we do it in terms of offering this solution is simplified in a very basic step, that is collecting the data from various sources, converting that data into relevant information. So once we have information on the software, on the platform, converting that information into the knowledge so that all the stakeholders who are associated or who are responsible for that activity can take action and again revalidate it. So as somebody mentioned in earlier presentation that when we talk about energy management system, it's a continual process. So the similar like what other ISOs are doing, ISO 50001 is also implemented in a similar manner. And our solutions help in every aspect and every stage of the entire cycle of data collection, data analysis, and the communication part, and validation of the action taken by the user. Next, please. So as I mentioned that we have diversified customer range across all the sectors, including automobile, textile, pharma. Now we have not only implemented at one of their facilities, but we have catered the requirement all across the units, all across the groups, in order to have the baseline as well as benchmarking comparison across their manufacturing facilities in India as well as abroad. Next, please. So we have some of the customers having specific requirement in terms of complying the ISO standards, in terms of power quality assessment, in terms of energy assessment and energy analysis. Next, please. So in terms of key metrics, we are diagnosing close to 1 billion energy units every hour on our platform. So with the help of analytics we have provided so far, we managed to save almost $5 million for all the customers put together. The entire reporting and analytics what we do provide are as per the relevant standard ISO 50001. We are also working closely with Industrial Modernization Center in Egypt in order to promote energy efficiency across small and medium scale industries in Egypt. We are also backed up by Microsoft from a technology point of view in order to provide the solutions for organizations. And we are one of the winners as a part of their Highway 200 Unicorn program. Next, please. So these are the four different solutions we are offering currently. First one is energy management system, which is mainly related with all types of energy data across the plant integrated with production data. The second one is overall equipment efficiency, which speaks with the machines operators so that organizations can identify the runtime, downtime, and the losses across the process line or the shop floor. Asset performance monitoring, mainly helping out in terms of creating the health index and the overall life cycle of the asset. On top of it, currently we are working on digital twin for these assets in order to give a prescriptive maintenance for the organizations, a way beyond a predictive maintenance that will enable users to identify as well as proactively act upon the failures that are going to occur across the plant because of the certain operating conditions on the machines. And in Smart Grid, we have a transformer ticketing and monitoring system and power quality assessment for electric vehicle charging stations. Next, please. So this is the high level architecture, how it looks like across the plant, any type of equipment or asset, be it chiller, boiler, furnaces, pressure gauges, compressors, UPS can be connected. As part of overall equipment efficiency, we can connect the machines with the HMIs or certain Android-based applications from our side. And then it gives a combined effect in terms of identifying kWh per kiloliter or kWh per kg or tonnage per man hour. That is what the ultimate baseline we are helping out in terms of the outcome to the end user. And the application is again on-premise solution, or it can be hosted on cloud, where organization don't have to maintain their IT infrastructure at the back end. And the reporting and analytics and alerts can be accessed across all the smart devices for the user. Next, please. So this is the typical architecture for energy management system. So be it pressure, temperature, flow, steam meter, water flow meters, any type of energy meter can be integrated with the IoT gateways, and that can be further connected to a cloud server or enterprise server, and which can be further accessed by the users. I have put down some of the sample screens. Next, please. So these are some of the sample screens in terms of identifying the executive dashboard, individual sensor-wide identification, cross-comparison of different sensors with the help of analytical modules based on AI and ML designed by us, and reporting structure with the single line diagram where user can have a real-time view of all the data sets and data structure of the plant with respect to production, with respect to the set benchmark and baseline created by either their auditors or by themselves, and they can configure various types of alerts. Next, please. So these are the some of the reports generated by our system, where we are combining the production data along with energy data in order to create the baselining for a particular type of a product getting manufactured across the organization. And there are, like, as per ISO, it will help you in defining significant energy usage areas and track the energy consumption accordingly for those. Next, please. So here you can see that in terms of the total plant area, how my energy is getting distributed across what type of product line, what type of manufacturing line. And based on that, user can take necessary actions in order to target the areas. So here it's like powder is consuming 49% of total energy consumption. The below graph shows that the target for a water-based plant in order to perform well is 20 kWh per kiloliter, and subsequently it's going on higher at a particular day. And there are further drill down analysis for the user in order to identify the machines or equipment where the energy consumption is going on the higher side. Next, please. So I think there is some issue on this slide, but this is going to give us the idea of last 3 years energy consumption data with the specific energy performance index of those equipments and assets with respect to the set guidelines as per ISO 50001. So this is... Next, please. So this is all from my side in order to showcase what the technology is helping out. And I would like to inform all the members that for MSMEs, we are planning to launch a very cost-effective module in terms of implementation for specifically for MSME. And we will roll out that circular soon to all MSME organizations as well as the clusters. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Vani, for highlighting the offerings by Innovative Solutions. Some of the points which are highlighted in terms of digital twin, which you are talking about for certain industry, I'm sure, like, moving forward, this type of concept will be definitely be interesting to not only MSME but build the industrial sector. Which can be implemented, how effective the monitoring can be done. And thank you for highlighting the concept of equipment efficiency, asset monitoring, which are very much important, not only for MSME but even for the large sectors also, sir, where we are not sure how our assets are performing, whether they require maintenance or not. Unless they fail, then only we try to focus on them, sir. So that is how energy management system and IoT solution and AI, which you have highlighted, sir, definitely help MSMEs to become more competitive, sir. So thank you.
I'll just add one point to your line, that in a conventional way, we are practicing preventive or condition-based maintenance. And in recent ages, technology is helping us to go for a predictive. But at Greenovative, we always believe to have a value addition where we are going for a prescriptive based maintenance for the organization. So that could be a game changer in terms of the data driven or AI driven, what I can say, not only maintenance, but the asset performance management put together. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. We'll be interested to know more about this approach which you're talking about, and we will see on the benefits which it can give to the industry, sir. And I'm sure it will be a great addition to for the energy monitoring system, sir. So
thank you.
Moving to the next presentation, we have from Systel Group of Companies. So energy efficiency in compressor systems is often, I would say, not a very much focused area in MSME sector. As long as the compressor is delivering air to the user, Akshay has highlighted in his presentation, the MSME thinks that, yes, my equipments are running properly and there is no issue there. But what happens is that if you see the compressor itself, the efficiency of the system is less than 20%. Most of the energy which is going in to deliver the compressor is either getting wasted as a heat or in getting over the friction in the compressor. So different losses are there. That is the reason we thought that Systel Group of Companies, their solution for compressor monitoring system, they are talking about Industry 5.0 in compressor. How the solution can help MSMEs to reduce their energy efficiency cost will be helpful. So we have with us Mr. Hiday, who is a managing director at Systel Group of Companies. He will be sharing the experiences of implementation of IoT and Industry 5.0 solution in compressor systems. Over to you, Mr. Hiday. Just a moment. Mr. Hiday, you can share the screen, sir.
Thank you, Atik.
Sure.
I hope my screen is visible. Good evening, everyone. I'm Hiday, managing director of
Sir, it is not getting to the full screen, sir. Varun, can you confirm from? Yes, sir. Now it is fine, sir. It is on full screen. Yeah, we can go ahead, sir.
Fine. So, good evening, everyone. I'm Hiday, a managing director of Systel Group of Companies. So, we are an Indo-Danish company formed in the year 2002 with a vision to simplify compressed air management. So in the last 18 years of our operation, we have improved over 1,600 compressed air systems across Asia Pacific. And all these projects has resulted in a combined energy saving of over 50 million megawatt hours in compressed air systems alone. And we were the first company in Asia Pacific to be certified under ISO 11011, which is the governing standard for compressed air assessment and management. And we are also the first company to introduce Industry 5.0 for compressed air systems in the Indian market. So we know that like throughout the life cycle cost of a compressor, energy forms a major chunk of it, like more than 76% of the cost spent towards energy, and capital and maintenance cost hardly remain 12% each. But what you may not be aware about is running a 100 HP compressor in a year would consume close to 648,000 kilowatt hours and wasting as much as 100 tons of greenhouse gas emissions. And it would, if it is a water-cooled compressor, then this 100 HP compressor might require around 5.1 million liters for its cooling requirement. And this compressor would produce close to 104,000 liters of condensate. And the compressors generate almost like 50% of the input energy in the form of heat. So a 100 HP compressor will generate close to 254,000 bitumen hours of heat energy. Compressed air systems, as we might be knowing, that like it is one of the most inefficient utilities, since almost like 70 to 80% of the input energy is wasted in the various forms, like heat loss contribute somewhere between 40 to 50%, leakages somewhere between 20 to 30%, artificial demand misuses and distribution losses. So hardly 10 to 15% of the input energy gets converted into a usable form and reaches the end point of use. So though compressed air is a very high cost intensive utility, There are a lot of puzzles that many users don't understand with it, like how much air is actually produced, because there is a big misunderstanding when it comes to the compressor's rated capacities, like what you assume as a capacity and what the manufacturer claims to be the capacity are completely two different terms. So usually, like there is many of the cases the industrial users, especially the MSME users, might be clueless about how much air is actually produced in the system, and they might not also have a clear idea about what is the actual requirement. Consumption and requirements are two different terms. So unless you know what is the actual requirement and what is the actual air produced, you might be not knowing about what is the losses that your system experiences. So that goes with the third puzzle of understanding what is the actual losses the system experiences and what are the equipment efficiencies. So when we don't have answers for these four puzzles, so our system is usually running inefficient. So this will create high energy cost, high maintenance cost in terms of increased wear and tear due to higher operation hours of compressors and allied equipments, heavy leakages, frequent breakdowns, poor air quality, and also production interruptions in case if the process is very sensitive to a stable air quality and stable system pressure. So in overall, when we don't know how much air we produce, how much we, what is the actual requirement, how much we consume, what are the different form of losses that the facility incurs, we will be ending up with the higher cost of ownership. So with Industry 5.0 solutions, we try to help you out to raise above the present energy cost wastages, your high greenhouse gas emissions to a higher operational efficiency and lower over cost of ownership. So this we try to do with the systematic and smart improvements. So we deploy Industry 5.0 for compressed air systems with the objective of moving from wastefulness to wastelessness. So what is Industry 5.0? So Industry 5.0 refers to people working alongside smart technology and smart machines. So it's about the smart technology helping humans to work in a much faster and better way by leveraging advanced techniques like Internet of Things and big data. And it also adds a personal touch to the Industry 4.0 pillars of automation and efficiency. So the objective of Industry 4.0 is to interconnect machines and systems for maximum performance optimization, whereas Industry 5.0 takes such efficiency and productivity a step further. So it's about refining the collaborative interactions between humans and machines. So Industry 5.0 is basically aimed at supporting and not superseding humans. Industry 5.0 is also about finding an optimal balance of efficiency and productivity. So with the many of the industries migrating towards Industry 5.0, the growth of Industry 5.0, even with the MSME sector, will be unavoidable in the future. So the first process with the Industry 5.0 is to start doing a baseline of your operating conditions. So we start with measuring what is the power input the compressor draws in to produce a unit of compressed air. So this we do it with our smart IoT-based power meters, which transmit the data in real time to our smart monitoring software. And we also have a pitot-tube flow sensor that's been fixed on the compressor output. So these measurements happen on a real time to understand what is the specific energy efficiency of the compressors. And with our smart pressure sensors, you can measure what is the pressure drop that is that your system is experiencing across the treatment equipments like filters and dryers, and a pressure dew point sensor to indicate what is the amount of moisture content or what is the amount of pressure dew point that your dryer is capable of achieving and delivering to the downstream of the system. A thermal mass flow sensor to indicate what is the consumption that is happening on the production header levels. And on the demand side, like we have thermal mass flow sensors deployed at the production department and also at the machine level. So they collect real-time data about what is the leakages the machines or your production process are experiencing. They also keep a track and understand what is the artificial demand that your system experiences. Artificial demand is a term referred to any excess consumption because of having unregulated pressure zones. So usually artificial demand is in the range of 5 to 10%, and the demand side optimization also collects data about the misuses that is happening across your system. Then the second step of Industry 5.0 is like we go with custom with user specific goals. So we define what is the system efficiency. This talks about what is a kilowatt your entire compressed air supply side of the system consumes to produce a unit of air. So for the best for the best standard, we recommend not to exceed a specific overall system efficiency of 0.17 kW per CFM. And at the compressors, it's always better, like when you're running a screw compressor, do not exceed a specific power of 0.155 or 0.16 kW per CFM. And maintaining a pressure dew point in case of a refrigerant dryer at less than 3 degrees CTD or for the desiccant dryer at minus 50 degree will be a key to avoid any recurrence of leakages, because leakages are not a problem on their own. They are symptom of a problem in the system. So when there is very excessive moisture contamination in your system, they create a rusting scaling in your pipelines. They also damage the O-rings or seals of your pneumatic components, so provoking new leaks. So maintaining a pressure dew point at these levels will help you to ensure that your system doesn't have excessive losses due to leakages. And maintaining pressures, maintaining the system with minimal pressure drop, and ideally designed the system should not exceed a pressure drop of 0.5 bar from the compressor discharge to the farthest point of the system. And leakages, like maintaining the leakages at less than 5% of the generation is highly recommendable. And maintaining dual pressure zones for different pressure applications, like Akshay was mentioning, that like avoiding the use of PRV valves and instead going for dual pressure zones, wherein you maintain high and low pressure for your pressure for your different pressure requirements. So we defined these five goals, which is basically specific to your industry and your applications. And then we also help you out in implementing the corrections. Like we offer a host of services like leak surveys, leak repairs, measurements, like both temporary and permanent measurements. We also do annual maintenance contracts. We do train your teams for best practices. We can also design a greenfield project, or we can also redesign your existing facilities. We conduct baseline audits. We conduct a performance validations for a variety of equipments like compressors, dryers, your air treatment equipments. We also make sure whether the air quality conforms to ISO 8573 standards. And so this is the third part of our Industry 5.0 offering. After defining the baseline and defining the goals, we help you in implementing all the corrective actions here. And with the deployment of our smart monitoring system, like we keep a track of your key performance indicators. So this is a dashboard view which gives you an complete insight of what is happening across your compressed air systems, both in terms of trending graphs and also in terms of like speed charts. So you get an indication of what is the core, what is the consumption that's happening in real time, and what is the power, what is the consumption in terms of power, and what is the overall system efficiency, and what is the cost that you are incurring for running your compressed air system. And with our smart monitoring system, you also get an automated reports, which gives you a snapshot view of the consumption parameters of your compressed air system. So with this, like I would like to go with a very brief case study. So this is a case study about India's, India's first specialty steel plant. So this plant is based in Tamil Nadu. So we started deploying Industry 5.0 solutions at this plant with an objective of achieving an energy saving of close to 17.5%. This particular end user was very conscious about the environmental and sustainability norms. So they were very particular that they need to save or reduce the greenhouse gas emissions here. So the second objective of the project was to reduce greenhouse gas emissions by up to 3,162 tons. And by reducing this 3,162 tons of carbon emissions, it is equivalent of planting 15,811 fully grown trees. And overall, in terms of cost benefits, like the project was aimed to deliver an energy saving of up to 2.32 crores per annum. So there was a five-step process towards this. We started installing the monitoring, smart monitoring. So wherein we deployed our smart IoT sensors for measuring flow, power, pressure, dew point, and overall system efficiency. And once the sensors, they started collecting the data, we did an extensive assessment on the baselines. So we defined the operating baselines for the entire equipments of the compressor system verticals, and also for the different production departments, and also on the machine level points. And once the baselines were defined, once the gaps were identified, we also implemented corrective actions like leak repairs by eliminating artificial demand, misuses, improving the supply side efficiency. And these actions have resulted in energy savings and reducing the footprints. So here, as you could see, they were running centrifugal compressors. So as you know, that all the centrifugal compressors are equipped with the orifice plate flow sensors. So these sensors basically are integrated. The measurement of these orifice plate flow sensors are directly integrated into the compressor's control panel. So when we measured the pressure drop across this particular orifice plate flow meter, it was observed that they were losing close to 46 kilowatts per hour just for measurement of flow alone with this orifice plate flow meters. So this was they had three compressor combinations with a total capacity of around 14,700 CFM. So this has resulted in an energy loss of up to 1,100 kilowatt hours per day. So we replaced all this orifice plate flow meters with our insertion type of pitot tube flow smart flow sensors. So these flow sensors are, since they are of insertion type, they do not induce any pressure drop in the system. So the return on investment for installing these sensors was hardly 83 days or just under 3 months. So this is a typical application of a pitot or insertion type of flow sensors. And the second point that we concentrated was on the dew point side. All the refrigerant dryers that you have, they show an indication of a particular value, which normally the user wrongly interprets as a pressure dew point. But it is the indication that you see here, the 3 degrees that you see here, is basically an indication of your evaporative chiller temperature. And this is not the pressure dew point. So at a 3 degree evaporative chiller temperature, your actual pressure dew point is somewhere between 18 degrees PDP, which means that you are permitting close to 250 grams of moisture for every kilogram of air that's been sent on the downstream of the system. So once we identified that the dryers were having a very high dew point, so we were able to relate that to the huge leakage levels the facility was experiencing. So they had a leakage level of 750 CFM, and the biggest problem with this facility was though they had an internal maintenance team who very periodically look into the leaks and conduct leak surveys and repair it, still they were experiencing reoccurrence of leaks. So once the dew point issue was addressed here by installing our pressure dew point sensors, which you use to alert the users in case if the pressure dew point is high above or reaches above the threshold point. So the user was able to immediately rectify the issues or look into the issues in the dryers. So this prevented the recurrence of leaks, and even after a year or so, the leakage level or the recurrence leakage level has drastically reduced by over 70%. So the investment for this 205 pressure dew point sensors and the return on the ROI calculation was just under 27 days. So when it comes to compressed air systems, nothing could pay you as fast as investing on a proper pressure dew point sensor. And on the department or on the end user level, there were so many vertex kind of flow sensors that was fixed in line on the pipeline. So these sensors were also inducing pressure drops of around 0.2 bars across the system. So these were all completely replaced with our insertion type of flow sensors. So the pressure drops were completely removed, and this particular facility was also having a department which was very sensitive to pressure fluctuations. So they have to run RDP with the compressors at a very elevated pressure level to meet out this pressure drops and pressure fluctuations. So there was a total of around 21 vertex flow sensors in the pipelines, which was creating a pressure drop of up to 1 bar in the system. So by replacing all these flow sensors with our smart insertion type of thermal mass flow sensors, we were able to reduce the consumptions by around 1,862 kilowatt hours per day. So the payback for this particular exercise was just under 9 months. So this is my last slide here. So in overall, the facility enjoyed saving of around 2.5% by avoiding pressure fluctuations, another 2.5% by avoiding leak losses, 5% by having a reduced artificial demand, and around 7.5% by improving the supply side efficiency. So the overall system efficiency has improved from earlier 0.21 kilowatt per CFM to around 0.19 kilowatt per CFM. So this has resulted in an energy saving of around 2.32 crores in a year. So the overall return on investment for this project was less than 6 months. You can contact us for any more details about Industry 5.0 in the given numbers here. Thank you CAA and WRI team for giving us this opportunity for presenting our views about Industry 5.0 and the benefit that it can pass to the MSME sector. Over to you, Atik.
Thank you, Desar, for sharing the presentation and experience of Sistel Asia on compressed air monitoring systems. So definitely the things which are highlighted, that though the focus more is on the generation part, but even the savings which we can achieve through artificial demand, supply fluctuation, leakages are much more as compared to the conventional area where we focus on to, sir. So thank you for highlighting it. I'm sure many of the industry members who are currently part of our participants here will be able to appreciate the benefits which we, the compressor monitoring system is able to achieve for our compressor system, sir. So now moving to the next presentation. Thank you, sir. Moving to the next presentation, we have energy efficiency in heating and cooling systems here. We have speakers from Aspiration Energy, where they will be sharing the offerings on heat pumps. As in MSME, we see a lot of thermal applications where we require some hot water for cleaning, for example, in automobile, in textile industry, for steam or hot water. So heat pump can be a very good solution, an energy efficient solution for meeting our energy needs here. So I will request Aspiration team, Aspiration Energy team, to please share their offerings for the MSME sector, sir. Over to you. Mr. Naveen Kumar and Sandeep, sir, can you please unmute? Yeah. Sandeep, sir.
Yes.
We are able to hear you, sir.
Can you hear us now, sir?
Yes. Yes. Clear, sir. You can start, sir.
Yeah. Okay, so warm good evening to everyone. So thank you for giving this opportunity to present about energy efficiency in heating and cooling system. Before getting into the presentation, I would like to take a minute to talk about Aspiration Energy. Next slide, please. Next slide. Next. So Aspiration Energy is an energy efficiency heating solution provider for industrial and commercial applications. Being established in 2009, we have deployed around 4.5 megawatt of heat pumps and 2.5 megawatt of solar thermal systems. So being one of the top major players of heat pump manufacturers in India, so we are the first company to deploy 90 degrees Celsius heat pump for industrial application. And also we also have one of the world's largest rooftop solar thermal system in Chennai. It's around 630 kilowatt capacity. Next slide. So these are our product line. Our core products are heat pumps and solar thermal system. Apart from this, we also do energy monitoring device to monitor the performance of the heat pump and chillers. So this will greatly help us in you know, monitoring the health of the system, and also suggest us like what should be the preventive maintenance to be taken care in this setup. And we are also currently working on the three projects. One is CO2 based heat pump, where both heating and cooling can be utilized. So in this system, we can generate hot water up to 90 to 95 degrees Celsius and can also generate cold water at around 5 degrees Celsius simultaneously. In the second project, 120 degrees Celsius heat pump, which can generate hot water up to 120 degrees Celsius or steam of 2 bar. In the third project, we are working on heat pump dryer. In food processing industries, drying is very common application. So we are primarily focusing on food processing industries to generate to manufacture heat pump dryers, which can generate hot air up to 80 to 90 degrees Celsius. Next. So before getting into the presentation, since a lot of companies are trying to adapt energy efficiency in their process applications, the heat pump is one of the best energy efficient solution available in the market. So the working principle of heat pump is similar to any air conditioner or chiller. It works on the principle of vapor compression cycle. Depending on the utilization point, the terminology of the system differs. If your utilization point is the evaporator, then it's called a chiller or an air conditioner. If it's your utilization point is a condenser, then it's called a heat pump. So the name itself suggests that it pumps heat from the lower energy to higher energy. So the working principle of heat pump, let's get into the working principle of heat pump. There are four main components in the heat pump system: compressor, condenser, evaporator, and expansion valve. So initially, the low boiling refrigerant inside this evaporator takes heat from the ambient air or the waste heat from the industrial processes and gets boiled. This superheated vapor goes to the compressor, where it's converted to high pressure and high temperature superheated vapor, which is then further fed into the condenser, where the refrigerant condenses to a subcooled liquid by giving off the heat to the process fluid going through the heat exchanger. So this super subcooled liquid is then again fed into the expansion valve, where it's depressurized to a mixer phase of gas and liquid. So this mixer phase of gas and liquid comes back to the evaporator. This cycle continues until the process temperature requirement is met. So generally, when we talk about efficiency, efficiency is defined as the output to the input. So to measure the performance of the heat pump, there is a special term called COP. COP is nothing but a coefficient of performance. The coefficient of performance of a heat pump is defined by the ratio of thermal energy generated by the heat pump to the input electrical energy supplied to the heat pump. Next slide. So here, the COP of the heat pump varies from 2 to 6, depending on the temperature requirement, refrigerant, and application nature. So what is that number means? Suppose if your COP is 4, for every 1 kilowatt of electrical input, the heat pump generates 4 kilowatt of thermal energy. When you look at industrial boiler or heater, for every 1 kilowatt of electrical input, the heater generates around 0.95 kilowatt of thermal output. An electrical boiler, the efficiency of the system is around 50 to 90% depending on the fuel. Here, this graph shows that the cost to generate 1000 kcal of energy. Here you can see that diesel, being expensive, spends around 8 rupees to generate 1000 kcal of energy, while the heat pump spends around 4 to 5 rupees to generate 1000 kcal of energy. Next slide, please. So let's get into the application. So where can we deploy heat pumps? So here, this list shows the number of different sectors and different process applications where the heat pump can be employed. So I would like to highlight few applications and few sectors. First, I would like to talk about the automobile sector. One of the common application in automobile sector is the pretreatment processes and component washing machines. In pretreatment process, it consists of a series of process tanks with acidic and alkaline solution, which needs to be maintained at a particular temperature. So generally, electrical heaters or boilers are used to maintain this temperature. So we can have a heat pump system that can generate hot water that will, this hot water can be recirculated to this process tanks, which through a heat exchanger, we can transfer the heat to the process tanks. So this is one application. We have done a lot of installations. Some of the installations we have done in TVS and Tata Motors and in Lucas TVS. And the second application in automobile sector is the component washing. So whenever the component is machined, it is covered with oil and greasy stuffs. To clean this component, generally automobile companies uses industrial washing machines with alkaline based solutions. So in industrial washing machines, this alkaline solution needs to be maintained at around 40 to 70 degrees Celsius. So generally electrical heaters are used to maintain this temperature. So instead of electrical heaters, we can have a heat pump system, so which can save up to around 50 to 60%, which can reduce their energy consumption by 50 to 60%. In the second sector, I would like to talk about the pharma company. So generally, the temperature and the humidity inside the pharma company is very important for their tablet formulation and medicine formulations. So generally, pharma companies use lots of air handling units with the heating and cooling coil to maintain the to do dehumidification and humidification. So for humidification, they use boilers. For dehumidification, chillers. For dehumidification, they use boilers. So instead of using chillers and boilers, we can have a centralized heat pump system that can supply chilled water to the cooling coil, also at the same time supplying hot water of around 50 to 60 degrees Celsius to the heating coils. Another application in the pharma sector is the tablet drying. So generally, hot air from the hot air generator is used to dry the tablets. So instead of boilers, we can have a heat pump dryer to replace the system. And in the food processing industry, there are a lot of applications. Some of the applications include like pasteurization, sterilization, CIP, and drying. So in dairy industries, during pasteurization, the milk is heated from 4 degrees Celsius to 70 to 75 degrees Celsius. Then it's immediately cooled down to 4 degrees Celsius. So the centralized boiler is used to heat the system, and also chiller is used to cool the system. So here we can have a CO2-based heat pump system, so which supplies both the heating and cooling for milk industries. And in CIP, generally, it's used to clean the process vessels. The typical temperature requirement ranges from 50 to 90 degrees Celsius. So we can have a heat pump system which can generate hot water in the range of 50 to 90 degrees Celsius. And food drying is one of the very common process. Like we use solar drying, we use a boiler or heaters to generate the hot air, which can further used for a drying process. So instead of this conventional heating system, we can have a heat pump system which works on very low energy. We can have this heat pump dryer setup system. So the rest of the system as presentation will be continued by Mr. Sandeep. Over to you, Sandeep.
Thank you, Naveen, for the wonderful introduction. And good evening, everyone. Now I would like to narrate a success story of Aspiration Energy in a three-wheeler manufacturing plant. Actually, it is in a paint shop where you wanted 55 to 70 degrees Celsius to be maintained in a pretreatment tanks, and for that 85 degrees of hot water has to be supplied, and they were using LPG as the source for getting 85 degrees Celsius and 650 kg per day of LPG. And parallelly on the electro deposition plant, because of the temperature was going from 25 to 30 degrees Celsius, and they wanted to chill it and get back the water at 25 degrees Celsius. So for that, they were using chiller, which was consuming around 100 units of electricity. So when we did the energy audit here, we got a perfect blend for here for the heat pump, where the heating load and the cooling load matched exactly. So it was a perfect saving for them here in this case. So a single heat pump could replace the LPG boiler, which was consuming 650 kg per day, and also the chiller, which was consuming 700 units of electricity per day. Next slide, please. So they had a great benefits because of this. So we can see that the total saving per year was around 71 lakhs, and the payback period was less than it was around 13 months. So here also one thing I would like to highlight: the carbon emission also. So 283 tons of metric tons of carbon was eliminated, and it is close to around 60 cars per used per year. Wow. Okay, so another important thing what I would like to highlight in this is that the integration process plays an important role in the efficient working of heat pumps. So actually, in the first set, they were not able to reduce the whole 650 kg of LPG, but they were able to reduce only 600. But after the setting their process parameters also, an integration was done, and they were able to completely eliminate the usage of LPG boiler. So the integration also plays an important role in the efficient working of the heat pumps. Next slide, please. So here you can observe here, so the payback period was just 13 months, and they are getting their benefits now. So next slide. So for this, the typical installation cost per kilowatt will range from 10,000 to 33,000 per kilowatt, and it depends on the integration, the complexity in the integration. So for this project, it was around 30,000 per kilowatt. Next slide. So we have got a huge demand for heat pumps, and this is the global industrial demand, and it has been segregated based on the temperature, application temperatures. So here we see that in India, actually, we are actually aspiration energy is the industry which is giving around 90 to 95 degrees Celsius in this range, and nearly 40 to 50% of the global industrial heat can be served using heat pumps. And if we will go beyond 100 degrees Celsius, and which is currently just 20% is being utilized. So if we have gone to next, our research is going on to go beyond 100 degrees Celsius. And now I'd like to tell about our research, which is going on for this. Next slide, please. So these are the ongoing innovations. So first innovation which is going on is the 120 degree steam generator. So we will be able to supply steam or hot water at 120 degrees Celsius. If you want steam, then we can give it at 2 to 3 bar and at a flow rate of 100 kg per hour. So this one is partly funded by Facility for Low Carbon Deployment, Technology Deployment, and UNIDO and CII. So this one, we got it in 2019, since we won the FLCTD Innovation Award. So we have finished with the procurement, and now assembly is going on. So this product is likely to be launched in March end, and field testing will be done at a site. So next slide. So the next innovation that is going on is on the CO2 heat pump, and CO2 is a natural refrigerant. Hence, it is the best eco-friendly refrigerant that can be there. The only problem with the CO2 heat pumps are the pressure, high pressures, how we have to maintain the high pressures, they have to deal with the high pressures. So the complexity in building the machines exist, and the cost of the compressor also is more, but the payback period will be less since the COP will be around 6.5. So this one, we are building it for a kitchen application. And the beauty of this product is that in a single pass, we can give from 24 degrees Celsius to 90 degrees Celsius. It's a single pass, we can heat it. And on the hot side, the heating capacity is 141 kilowatt. And on the parallel, on the cold side, from 12 degrees Celsius to 5 degrees Celsius, we can get the cold side, and the cooling capacity is 102 kilowatt. This one, we are doing it in collaboration with NTNU Norway and SINTEF Norway. This is for a kitchen application. So this is the best eco-friendly refrigerant with a high COP that is possible. Then this will be the first CO2 implications in India. So next slide. So on the next, we are also parallelly working on the refrigerant selections. That is, presently, we will tell that we are also using the eco-friendly refrigerant, but we are only deciding it based on the GWP. If we are using the low GWP refrigerant, we cannot simply say that it is eco-friendly, because when we are using a low GWP refrigerant in place of a refrigerant which is conventionally used like R134a or R407c, the problem exists is the performance slightly reduces. So when the performance slightly reduces, the electricity consumed by the compressor increases. So as a result, if we are deploying a heat pump in the region where during the production of electricity, the CO2 that is being emitted is more, that is, if they are not depending on the renewable sources for generating their electricity, then it is of no use. Actually, it will be dumping more CO2 into the environment. So currently in India, from 2012, the emission factor, that is 0.83 kg of CO2 emitted for producing 1 kWh of electricity. So in those cases, we cannot simply tell that because I'm using a low GWP refrigerant, so I am eco-friendly. Actually, it will, because if we will see the electricity produced emission factor, then it will actually dump more CO2 into the environment. So we have to go for a total equivalent warming impact type of analysis, or we have to go for a analysis called life cycle climate performance. So in total equivalent warming impact, we will be seeing the direct emissions because of the refrigerants, because of the direct leakage, or plus also the indirect emissions which is caused by when producing electricity in the area of deployment of the heat pump. So this is TEWA analysis, and LCCP analysis also considers, along with the direct emission and indirect emission, it also considers the CO2 that is emitted while manufacturing the other components of the heat pump. So this type of holistic approach is required to say that, yes, I am using an eco-friendly approach. So this is the AEPL's chasm. So we have done quite a number of products in the automotive sector, and now slowly we are moving to the chemical industry and as well as for the pharma industries. So we are trying to expand in multiple sectors to save energy and give energy efficient solutions. Thank you. Next slide.
So thank you very much, sir, for highlighting the application of heat pumps and the thermal side, meeting the thermal energy requirements for the industry. The solution which I highlighted, steam generator, we will eagerly looking forward to the results which you'll be able to achieve, sir, and so we can see wide-scale implementation also. Now, I would request WRI team to please take the poll questions and Q&A session now.
Sure. Thank you, Atik, so much. So I'll be launching the polls first. They're just two. And then there's one question from Mr. Vineet Kulkarni that I'll take after. So I'm launching the poll now. This is a multiple choice question. So please feel free to choose more than one option. And you have around 30 seconds for this as well. We have around 10 more seconds. So these are the responses that we found. Atik, do you want to just quickly go through this? The answer?
So as you are aware that many of the energy efficiency measures have been introduced by various government departments and agencies, like for example, Bureau of Energy Efficiency has come up with PRGF or VCFE program, then SIDBI has come up with 4E program few years back, and now still some programs are available for energy efficiency also. And from Ministry of Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises also, we see that there are various schemes, not directly in form of energy efficiency, but technology upgradation, TICUP scheme, and many others are there. So, and also we see that more 37% of the participants have given they are not aware or availed any government scheme so far. So definitely, if you attend the upcoming sessions on financing and policy model, we will try to cover all this stakeholders and try to share the schemes which you can avail for taking energy efficiency or implementation of energy efficiency measures at your premises. Yeah, over to you, Tejaswini.
Thank you, Atik. So I'll launch the last question for this session today. Again, this is multiple choice questions. Feel free to pick more than one answer. You have around 5 seconds more. Okay. Some really interesting responses. Mr. Atik?
So as you are aware that we have two upcoming webinars under this training series. So as many of you have highlighted that you want to understand renewable energy opportunities available to MSME sector in India. So definitely we will try to cover solar PV as well as solar thermal applications in MSME sector. What are the models? So today, Kajol was talking about RESCO model also. So we have seen that Akshay, Kajol were talking about ESCO and RESCO model. So definitely in financing, we will try to invite few of the ESCOs, ESL or other stakeholders who are there and share their offerings for it. And greater resource efficiency, definitely we will cover more in detail in our next session. But as many of you have highlighted, water and waste management also. So here also we have seen many new applications, like there are few companies who provide water related IoT solutions, like today we have seen for compressed air and energy. But even for water, your ATP or WTP plant also, we have many of this innovative technologies and opportunities available for you to tap. So please, whenever, like in next few months, we will be having these sessions. So based on your feedback, we will try to incorporate those in our agenda and take it forward then. Over to you, sir. Please.
Thank you. So I have one question for Mr. Vineet. The question is from Mr. Riaz Hussain, who says, while we understand that IoT-based solution is very helpful for companies to take data-driven decisions, but we don't see many companies taking this up. And it, although it's not very expensive, can you shed some light on that as to why?
Okay. So basically what I understand is the question from the adoption point of view for making the decisions based on the data received from the technology or IoT. In last 6 or 8 months prior to COVID or this pandemic, there was a bit hesitation in terms of adopting the technologies. But once it got started and people started realizing that if I have something where I can operate or at least monitor my plant remotely, so that gave a bit of boost in terms of adopting this type of solutions, what we have seen in terms of change from the psychology point of view of the buyer. And on the other hand, people most of the time think that if I have done the energy audit at one time and I have implemented the measures recommended by the auditor from that report, so I really don't have to bother about or look into the new opportunities, or I'm done with what I'm supposed to do based on that report. So even while interacting with many of the auditors, I keep on insisting that you should at least say that customer should have the real-time monitoring, because that is going to give a real-time or the precise identification of the areas and the measures they have implemented in terms of validating those. So there is a gradual shift or a change which is happening across. It is not in terms of all of a sudden drastic change we have seen, but gradually people are adopting in nowadays, which I can say now.
Okay, thank you so much, Mr. Vineet. So there's one more question, I think, for Mr. Naveen and Mr. Sandeep. Why heat pump application in India is not very widespread?
I think it's mainly because it's about the awareness of the system. So we recently did a study on heat pump systems in India. So we found that the majority of the heat pump system being implemented in India is in the residential and commercial sector. On the industrial side, there is very little awareness about the heat pump system. So if we could make more awareness about the heat pump system, we can have a lot and lot of application. So right now, the major sectors explored by the heat pump manufacturers in India is the automobile sector. Other sectors has not yet been explored. So once we move into other sectors and once we have a lots of installation and awareness with the other MSME companies, so we can have this, we can implement a heat pump in predominantly in almost in all sectors.
And another point to be added is that lack of low payback period they have thought, but the payback period also depends on the integration process that is possible. And the, as I showed in the success story, the payback period is less than 30 months. So there is a misconception that the payback period is very high for heat pump, so it's not viable. And another barriers for this heat pump implementation is the high temperature application. So many of the industries require high temperature applications are available, and they require steam also. So as you can see, our project which is going on for the steam generator, I think it may pick up the market.
Thank you so much, Mr. Naveen and Mr. Sandeep, and also Mr. Vineet. Over to you, Atik, for some closing remarks.
First of all, I will like to thank all the speakers today, starting from Akshay, then Mr. Amol, Kajol, then Mr. Suresh, and all the technology suppliers, Mr. Vineet, Mr. Hiday, and Naveen and Mr. Sandeep, for taking time and sharing their experience. I'm sure the participants would have found a lot of interesting opportunities to implement in their operations. So I see that we have participation from large companies also, and many small and medium enterprises also, sir. All the participants, kindly note that we will be sharing the slide deck with you all with required contact details of the technology suppliers. So in case you were not able to ask the questions immediately and you want to have one-on-one discussion with the technology suppliers, you can definitely do that. We'll be sharing the contact details with you all. And this was the training series on energy efficiency. Subsequently, we will have training sessions on resource efficiency and policy and financing options for reducing GHG emissions in MSME sector. So please do participate in the upcoming sessions also. We will again have different speakers, technology suppliers who will be sharing their experiences. And we would like to thank our funder, Ellen MacArthur Foundation, for their support for these activities under the project. And if you want to access the training link for GHG accounting and previous two webinar series, it is already included in the slide deck. So you can please go through the recording and see what can be useful for you on those sessions also. With this, I will hand over to WRI now. And again, I would like to thank all the speakers, participants for taking their time, even though we are late by some 15 minutes, but I'm sure that we see that good number of participants are still there. So I'm sure that the session was very useful to all of you. Over to you, Megha. Thank you.
Thanks, Atik. Thank you everyone for joining us today. This was really great, and thank you to all our speakers as well. I think with this, we can wrap up the session now. Varun, yeah.
Thank you all. Have a good evening.
Thank you very much. I'm going to end the webinar now. Have a good evening, and we look forward to seeing you for the upcoming training sessions in this series.